I want to start today with a hand raise question. I'm actually going to ask a hand raise question at the end of today. So we're going to bookend this whole thing with some hand raises. How many of you would say, honestly, I'm struggling with something in this world right now? That ought to be about all of us. Now, I know some of you are like, too cool, and I'm not going to play the pastor's game, and I get it. I'd more than likely be you, too, if I was sitting there. Some of you are like, I'm just not struggling with anything. I don't know if I'm jealous or hate you, but good for you, you know? Good for you. If that's you, take today's talk and store it away for a rainy day, because I promise you, you'll need it at some point. Amen? You just will. We're in week two of a teaching series called Grit, and Doug did an amazing job of kicking this thing off last week. In fact, a little too good, if you ask me. The theme verse, as Doug said, is Philippians 3, 13, and 14. Paul says, listen, I know life gets hard. I know there will be times when we struggle. I know there will be things that are really disappointing. I know there's going to be these times when I really wanted something to happen and it doesn't. I know there's going to be times when I really didn't want something to happen and it did. I know there's going to be those times. He said, I've experienced those times. And he said, here's what I do. One thing I do, I forget what is behind. I take all that stuff that's been really hard to deal with and really scary and really hurtful and really frustrating and made me really sad and really mad. I take all that stuff and I put it behind me, forgetting what is behind, and I strain. I'm straining toward what is ahead. I press on toward the goal to win the prize for which God has called me heavenward in Christ Jesus. That's grit. He says, I've been through some stuff, but I am making a purposeful, intentional decision. I'm not gonna sit around and have a pity party for myself anymore. I'm putting all this stuff behind me. It's gonna take some straining, but I'm gonna press forward. I'm gonna walk in the calling that God has for me. Come hell or high water, that stuff's behind me. Here we go. That's grit right there, church. That's what we're talking about in this series. Grit, as Doug also said last week, I'm basically just going to repeat his message. As Doug also said last week, grit for us, this is our definition, a God-given ability to step out and press on in difficult situations. We need this, don't we? We need this because life is real and because life happens and because sometimes we do get disappointed and because sometimes we do get hurt and because sometimes life does get difficult. And I just want you to know that at Red Rocks Church, we don't think you need to show up here and hide that. Right. This should be the place, the one place in your week where you get to show up and go, I'm not gonna dress up for this thing. I'm not gonna pretend for this thing. If we're really gonna go meet with the great physician, then I'm gonna come up in here and go, this is where I'm hurting right now. Right? Because wouldn't it be crazy to go to the hospital and hide where you're hurting to go see a doctor? Right? And so we're going to come in here. I want you to go here. I want you to go to your small group, your sports teams, your serve teams, whatever you're a part of at this church, and just kind of get that in your soul. I'm not going to hide when I'm hurting. I'm supposed to do life with other Christ followers. I'm supposed to share my burdens. I'm going to let some people know I'm hurting. I'm going to come to a church and I'm going to bare my soul and go, God, I do have some struggles. I do have some issues. I need the great physician, and let's meet with the great physician and start to get some healing, right? I had the most freeing talk with a guy here on staff named John Trowbridge this week. John's been here forever, probably prays for this church more than any of us. And he was walking outside this Littleton campus, and if you know John, you'll know this is him. He was holding two bags of Planters potting soil, because that's what he does. And John, thank you, because the plants look amazing here. And he had the soil, and he goes, hey, Sean, are you good today? And I went, I sure am. And I kind of kept walking, and he goes, hey, Sean, are you really good today? And I go, you know what, John? No, I'm not. I'm not good today, but I don't have time to tell you about it, so see ya. And I just kept walking, and he goes, okay, see ya. And it was kind of freeing. I didn't have to hide it anymore. I'm not doing that good today. I'm not gonna tell you about it right now, I don't have time, but I'm just not, and it's okay to say it. We don't have to hide it. Because life has troubles, as Jesus said it would until heaven, sometimes it gets really hard for you and me to hold on to things like sometimes our faith in general, Sometimes our mind goes, well, if God was good and if God was real and if God cared, this wouldn't even happen. Maybe I won't even hold on to my faith. It gets hard to hold on to things like hope. Like I actually think life is going to get better, that things are going to change, that my dreams are going to happen, that this God-given calling I think I'm supposed to be walking in is actually gonna work out. Sometimes it's hard to hold on to that hope, isn't it? Sometimes it's hard to hold on to things like peace and joy and confidence. It's hard to hold on to this trust that God is actually with me and working even though I can't see it and feel it right now. Isn't that true? Life sometimes gets so hard. It gets hard to hold on to these things. And so the title of today's message is, Don't Let Go. In fact, tell your neighbor right now, say, don't let go. If you're in the chat right now, if you're online, type it in the chat, don't let go. In fact, if you're sitting next to someone online in a living room or in a building, say to one of your neighbors right now, I'm not gonna let you let go. I'm not gonna let you let go. I like that. My life goal right now, one of them is to not let go. I've been saying to some of my close friends, one of the things I wanna do right now is I wanna figure out how to live really well even when life really hurts. I don't wanna let go of things like peace and joy and gratitude and confidence in my God and the calling that he's put on my life. I don't wanna mentally or emotionally or actually sort of tangibly let go of these things, even when life gets really hard. What I know as one of your pastors is one of the best things I have to offer you is authenticity. I've always known that. I don't have doctorate degrees in theology. I know that's gonna shock you. I'm not all that articulate. I'm not Doug. That man is a wordsmith. He is an artist with his words. I'm not that. I've always known one of the best things I have to offer you is just real. Just be me. And one of the ways I do that is I share things when I have struggles. Well, a couple weeks ago, I was having a really tough week. And in fact, after that week, I remember I was brushing my teeth at the bathroom and Jill was in there and I got done and I was like, I know what I'm gonna do. I'm gonna do a message called, Help, I'm really struggling right now. And then I started feeling like a wuss for even thinking about it. And so I put together three other messages this week. It takes a lot of time to put together three other messages. I couldn't get it out of my system. I couldn't get it off my heart. I felt like it was God sort of pushing me back to, no, why don't you go be vulnerable? And why don't you go share some of your struggles because it's gonna help somebody else with their struggles. And that's what I'm hoping for today. I was having a bad week. I had a rough couple weeks, but one in particular. I had 4 days of doctor's visits in a row because of this Parkinson's diagnosis. And every single day and every single appointment was just sort of this constant reminder of what's happening right now. And that started messing with me. And some of the neurologists are now changing some medicines. So they've taken me off of certain medications and they're putting me on some other medications. And to be honest, it's really started messing with my system. Like I started getting real bad headaches. I started feeling really dizzy. My emotions started getting all over the place. I started finding myself getting angry in a heartbeat. Like I was messy. I was a mess. I got in a fight with my wife. It was my fault, all of it. And I said some things that I wish I didn't. And you know, words can't be taken back. Yeah, I can say I'm sorry, but the words are out there. And then she left to go out of town to a women's conference. And I just sat at home feeling really guilty for a few days. Like I just suck as a husband. And so this whole week, it was just like, man, mentally I'm kind of a mess. And physically I'm kind of a mess. And emotionally I'm kind of a mess. And I feel guilty right now. And I feel sad. And I feel mad. And I feel hurt. And I feel confused. And sometimes I'm even mad at God. Sometimes I just feel mad at the world. Have you ever felt that? Like these emotions are just real sometimes. That's kind of where I was. And the problem is I do want to continue to live really well, even when life really hurts. There's some things I have decided I'm gonna hold on to. And all these emotions are very, very real at the same time. And so I found myself going, now what? Because I really feel these things and I really wanna live this way. And everything I feel is sort of opposite of how I wanna live right now. And I'm standing in the middle just struggling with it and don't know what to do. And so I thought, well, maybe I should do some of the things I would tell you to do. Maybe I should start there. So I started digging into the Bible and kind of doing some things I just know I should do. And I found myself at the end of this week to 2 week period going, man, I feel a lot better already. And I looked back and there was like four main things that I did. And I just couldn't get it out of my heart this week to share these four things with you, that if you're struggling and your emotions say do this and your mind says do this and you find yourself in the middle, here's what you can do. All right? Amen? Sound good? First thing I realized I needed to do was I needed to pray through the pain. On autopilot, I like to complain through the pain. That's what I do. I come from a long line of complainers. We are good at complaining. I come from a long line of pity party throwers. My family, we are great. We are almost a professional level of pity party throwers. We're just good at it. And as I looked up the family tree and I started thinking about, like, here's what I've realized. Nothing's ever our fault. The world's always against us. Somebody's always wronged us. We always got the short end of the stick, and we always want to tell you about it. We're just good at this. And on autopilot, I don't pray through the pain. I complain through the pain. And I realized if I can choose either, but only one of them's going to get me where I want to go. So I think this time, let's try praying through the pain. It's exactly what the Apostle Paul tells us to do. And he knows pain. Doug talked about that last week. Again, this is Doug part two. Last week, though, he told you about some of Paul's history, the things he's been through, wrongful imprisonments and beatings and floggings and snake bites and shipwrecks and just crazy stuff. He's been through a lot of pain. And I love that he's just honest about it because it gives us the permission to be honest about ours. But one time he tells his friends, he says, "We don't want you to be uninformed, brothers and sisters, about the troubles we experienced in the province of Asia. We were under great pressure, far beyond our ability to endure, so that we despaired of life itself." Listen to what he's admitting to a bunch of church people. He says, "I'm trying to walk in God's calling, and I was under so much pressure. My emotions were so all over the place. My feelings were so all over the place that there were times when I didn't even want to keep living." However, he also wrote, "I'm going to put this stuff behind me and I'm going to strain and I'm going to push forward and I'm going to go get the calling that God has for me." So he finds himself in the middle of life really hurts and I want to live really well. What do I do? He tells some of his friends at a church he started in Philippi, he said, "Here it is. Here's where it starts. Rejoice in the Lord." Back up. "Rejoice in the Lord always. I will say it again, rejoice." He said, "I'm going to start out with some worship. Let your gentleness be evident to all. The Lord is near." Here it is. "When you're really overwhelmed and when you're really disappointed and when you're really nervous and really scared and really worried, do not be anxious about anything. But let's start to pray through this stuff. But in every situation, by prayer and petition with thanksgiving, present your request to God. And here's what you're going to find. The peace of God, which transcends all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus." Paul says, when you're really hurting and your emotions are over here and the way you want to live is over here and you find yourself in the middle of it, pray through the pain and throw some worship on it. And he says, what you're going to find is this peace of God that doesn't even make sense is going to start flooding into your life. And you're going to blink and you're going to turn around and go, "I got a little bit more peace than I had right then because I decided to pray through some pain instead of just complain through some pain." I love that he breaks down even the what to talk to God about because he knows pain. And he knows that sometimes we get so overwhelmed and our emotions are so out of control and we get so disappointed and sometimes, let's be honest, so mad at God, and he can handle it. It's okay. That if I pray, I don't even know what to say. What? I'm in between help me, Jesus, and forget you, Jesus. Let's be honest. I don't know what to say today. Paul goes, "Let me help you out with that. I got you," because I know how hard that is. He says, first start with just the prayer. Start with the prayer. Just pray. Just go talk to him. And can I say this, Red Rocks Church? Go talk to God this week, real and raw and honest. He doesn't need you to dress your prayers up for him. He doesn't want you to come pretend you're something that you're not. He doesn't need you to pretend you're happy when you're not. He doesn't need you to pretend you're confident when you're not. Real, raw, honest is how I've been praying recently. And I've said some things in prayer, being real and raw and honest, that I've actually had to repent for the next day. I'm like, hey, God, that's my bad. You know, I was having a day. And thank you for not hitting me with lightning when I said that. I'm telling you, he can handle your bad days. He can handle your real and your raw and your honest. I'm a dad. I have three boys. That's the only way I want them to come to me. I don't ever want my boys to feel this pressure of, I gotta be on my A game if I go talk to dad. See what I'm saying? I don't ever want my boys to come talk to me and like, pretend you're good when you're not, son. Pretend you're happy when you're hurting. Pretend you feel great when you don't. I don't ever want that. I always want real and raw and honest so I can be part of it with them. That's what your Heavenly Father wants. Start it with that. I'm just gonna talk to God this week and I'm just gonna talk to him real and raw and honest. Paul says, just pray, just talk to him. And he says, petition. That's the asking God for what we need. I'm not gonna spend much time on that because for a lot of us, if we're honest, that's about the only way we pray. That's about the only time we pray, some of us. That's me in some seasons. If you could go back and look at your last month of prayers, wonder what the percentage of them, of you either blessing food or asking him for something would be. Pretty high, probably. God, would you please help me with the, dear God, please don't let that cop see me speed. Dear God, please help me with this. Dear God, please help me with this relationship. Please help me with this illness. Please help me with this problem. Please help me with this situation. Please, 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 please. We do that on autopilot, and we should, and God wants us to. We're invited. He says, step into my throne room of grace with confidence in your time of need and get mercy and grace from me. He wants us to bring him this stuff. There's nothing wrong with that. You're his son. You're his daughter. He's your father. Absolutely make that part of your prayer time, Paul says. Be real, raw, and honest. Tell God what you want. But then Paul says, don't miss the magic. Don't miss the thanksgiving. He said, there is something supernatural that will begin to change in your heart, in your mind, in your emotions, when you on purpose go, God, here's my real, here's what I need. But now I've been focusing on and talking to you about and thinking about everything I need. Now I'm going to on purpose recalibrate. I'm gonna go over here. I'm gonna go, but I got a whole bunch of things that you've already done in my life that I'm really, really grateful for. I'm gonna bring those over here and I'm gonna intentionally focus on them. I'm gonna stop focusing on my problems for a minute and I'm gonna start focusing on some things I have to praise you for. And I got a long list, God. On one of my worst days, I just made a list. I just got out my phone and made a list. And on that list was my wife and my boys and this church and my friends. And I started just everything I could think of, like, God, thank you that I can walk today. Thank you that I have air in my lungs. Thank you that I have the mental capacity to sit here and make a list. I'm gonna on purpose refocus and on purpose think about what I have to be thankful for, and I'm gonna tell you about it, God. Prayer, petition, thanksgiving, and throw some worship on it. Paul says, watch, peace will start to replace anxiety in ways you can't even explain. During this tough week, I was at the gym one day and I was on the treadmill. I hate treadmills. I hate cardio in general. My problem is it's starting to show, so I'm like, I probably could use some cardio because I like to eat donuts. And so, I love your laugh, by the way, whoever's over here. You're just... I don't know if you guys can hear that through the cameras, but it's fantastic. Security. I'm on the treadmill. I hate the treadmill. No matter what I do, I try to listen to podcasts, I watch messages, I listen to music, whatever I try to do, my mind just starts to wander on the treadmill because it's just boring, all right? And so now I'm running and thinking, making sure I'm faster than you, and then I'm running and thinking. Yes, we're in a race, you don't know it. I'm running, I'm thinking. And my thoughts, on autopilot, I bet you'll understand this, sometimes just go negative. They just start to cave in. Without purposefully trying to focus on some positive things in my life, if I'm just like letting whatever thought pops in there take over, a lot of times they go negative. And I'm on this treadmill, and all of a sudden I started thinking, poor me. It's not fair. Shouldn't be happening. Why me? What if? What's gonna happen? I'm mad, I'm sad, I'm this, I'm that. And all of a sudden it hit me. I've gotta lock it up because I'm about to start crying next to this 16-year-old girl on a treadmill at the gym, and I can't do that here. I instantly hit stop, got in my car, drove to my house, went in my little office, put on worship music, got on my knees, said, God, I need you. I'm hurting today, and I need you, and I put on some worship music, and just real and raw and honest, and my wife got home, and she heard me in there, and she came in, and we just started praying out loud together. And then we ended up holding hands and praying together, and all I can tell you is, I walked out of that office with more peace than I walked in. He means what he says. You can pray through the pain or you can complain through the pain, but only one of them gets you where you want to go. And there's nothing weak about this. Sometimes we feel weak for needing to do this. Can I just remind you that this is what Jesus himself had to do? It's what Jesus did. The night he was about to be arrested, he knows I'm about to be arrested and flogged and beaten and spit on and a crown of thorns shoved in my head and beams put on my back and marched to the top of a hill and I'm about to be crucified. The most excruciating form of execution known to man in public. And he's like starting to feel it. Like this, he's fully God, but he's also fully human. He's starting to feel it. He took Peter and the two sons of Zebedee along with him, and he began to be sorrowful and troubled. Think about this. He said to him, to some of his best friends, guys, my soul is overwhelmed with sorrow to the point of death. Some of you say, I know that feeling. Would you stay here and keep watch with me? And going a little farther, he fell with his face to the ground and he prayed. Jesus himself said, I can complain through this or I can pray through this. And I know where I want to go in life, so I'm going to pray through this one. Jesus needed it. Paul needed it. We need it. Let's decide to do it. Pray through the pain. Number two, hold on to a promise. I'm going to give you 10 here in a minute. You're welcome to use one of those. They're not mine. They're God's. Or the beautiful thing of the world we live in right now, you can just Google it. You can Google a Bible verse on anything you want and go hold on to that promise. We're in my office praying, and Jill took my phone and she had her Bible and she actually read this verse out of her Bible into my phone. She said, I want you to keep this all week, and it's this. You will keep him in perfect peace whose mind is stayed on you because he trusts in you. I just started holding on to that because my emotions were lying to me. You know that your emotions lie to you. You're not really gonna be this way for the rest of your life. You don't really wanna give up on everything. You don't really wanna spend a month in the basement. You don't really wanna eat Krispy Kremes and cry all night. Well, maybe you do that one, but you don't. My emotions were lying to me. And they were saying things like, what if you start to spiral down and you find yourself in the same spot you did 3 years ago with anxiety? What if this depressed feeling you have right now will never go away? What if you aren't going to be able to walk in your calling? What if your life isn't going to be the same? You're never going to pull out of this. Like my emotions were lying to me. The truth is I was having a bad day, not a bad life. And I do trust God and my mind is on him. And he promises me perfect peace. So I'm gonna hold on to that on the hard days. I'm gonna take that promise to the bank and go, I'm not gonna listen to the lies that I tell myself, that my emotions are feeding me, that Satan wants to whisper in my ear. I don't have to let go of faith. I don't have to let go of hope. I don't have to let go of trusting my God to get me through something I don't know how he's gonna get me through. I don't have to let go of joy. I don't have to let go of peace. I don't have to let go of confidence, because I'm gonna hold on to the truth of the Word of God. We can do that. Number three, get somebody fighting with you. There's something about us that when we're hurting, what we do on autopilot is hide it. Everything inside of me wants to hide it. And I bet you, some of you know what that feels like. I just feel stupid. I don't want you to know how bad I feel on the inside, because I feel weak. And I feel ashamed of the way I feel. I feel ashamed of the fact that I'm struggling as bad as I am, because I ought to be able to trust God better. I ought to have better faith. I ought to be a better Christian. I ought to be a stronger person. And I don't want you to know how weak I am. So I'm gonna do everything I can to hide that. But we miss out on so much that God has for us when we do. I could go to a bazillion places in the Bible to just go let God speak to you on this one. And this was the first one that popped in my mind. It's Exodus 17, and the nation of Israel, they're in this battle, and Moses is gonna go up to the top of the hill and pray. And when he holds his hands up in the air, the Israelites are winning the battle. And when his hands drop, they start losing the battle. Watch what happens. As long as Moses held up his hands, the Israelites were winning. But whenever he lowered his hands, the Amalekites were winning. When Moses' hands grew tired, Get a picture of this in your mind. They took a stone and put it under him, and he sat on it. So now Moses is sitting on this big stone. Aaron and Hur, his boys, held up his hands, one on one side, one on the other, so that his hands remained steady till sunset. So Joshua overcame the Amalekite army with the sword. He had some people in his life that said, I will stick with you until we see a victory. I'm not going anywhere. You're not strong enough to get through this on your own. We're not supposed to be. We're created to walk in the plans of God with the people of God. That's why at all four of your Denver campuses today, you've already probably heard your campus pastors talk about Grow, which happens right after the 11 o'clock service. So those of you at the 9, come back after the 11 o'clock service. And we're gonna help you in 2 weeks. We're gonna help you identify your gifts. We're gonna help you get on a team, get in a group, find community, start walking forward with some other believers, because there's gonna be a time when you need it, and you're gonna need somebody who actually puts God first in their life to be on each side of you going, I got you, until you see a victory. I wanna help you get there. Show up and grow today. Bear one another's burdens and so fulfill the law of Christ. There is supernatural power in this. Our problem is, I don't wanna share my burden, so there's not a chance in the world you're gonna get to help me bear it. We gotta get past that. We gotta fight. Sometimes fight through some pride, humble ourselves, and say, I need some help, guys. But there's power in that. And the fourth one, and this is the one I probably struggle with the most, but what I needed the most that particular week is be still. I don't like that one. I wanna fight everybody and everything when I'm hurting. I'll figure it out and I'm gonna fight through it. Me and Joe were sitting on the couch in my office and we were praying, and I don't think I've ever prayed this prayer before. I don't know what caused me to pray it, but I remember saying these words. I said, God, I want you to put a fighter spirit inside of me. I want a warrior spirit. That's what I said. I want a warrior spirit inside of me, because I'm gonna fight through this. And we got done and we said amen. And my wife said, babe, she goes, I know you're a fighter. I know it. But every now and then, it's okay to say, God, I need you for this one. This one's bigger than me. Every now and then it's okay to go, God, the fight is through my pride, so that again, I can humble myself and go, God, I just need you, because this one's above my pay grade. This one's above my strength. I need your strength. Exodus 14, Moses answered the people, do not be afraid. This is gonna speak to some of you. Some of you that are like, I got this on my own. I don't need help. I don't need God. I got grit. I got it all. Do not be afraid. Stand firm. You're not letting go of grit. You're tapping into some God-given grit on the inside of you that's going to allow you to humble yourself. Stand firm and you will see the deliverance the Lord will bring to you today. Let the word of God speak to some of you right now about your situation. The Egyptians you see today, that's just whatever you're battling. That's what these guys were battling. The Egyptians you see today, you will never see again. The Lord will fight for you. You need only to be still. There's going to be a time when the struggles get so bad that you go, I don't have what it takes to get through this one on my own. And that's not a point of weakness. That's actually when strengths begin, right? Because when I'm at my weakest, he is at his strongest. And so there's some of that fighter spirit in you needs to fight through some pride and go, God, this one's too big for me to handle on my own. I need you to get involved in this one. I'm just going to be still for a minute. And I'm going to let you flex because that's what I need. Pray and worship. Hold on to a promise. Get somebody fighting with you and be still. Would you put up those 10 verses that I have promised? Would you guys take a screenshot of this? If you're in a building, get out your phones and take a screenshot of this. If you're on a device, on your phone, on your computer, whatever, hit whatever magic buttons you need to hit, get a screenshot of this. I want you to have some artillery as you go to war this week for yourself or for a loved one. These are 10 promises, and I'm about to read every single one of them, and as I do, here's what you're going to see. Every single one of these is the God of the universe saying, don't you dare let go. Hold on. I got you. Don't you dare let go of your faith. Don't you dare let go of your hope. Don't you dare let go of this dream. Don't you dare let go of that confidence. Don't you dare let go of gratitude. I'm with you. I got you, and when I got you, you got this. My temptation was to let you take that screenshot and go dig into those on your own, but I thought, you know what, the truth is, if you're really hurting today, what you need is less of my voice and more of God's voice. And so I'm gonna read these. I know it's crazy, we're gonna read 10 whole verses in a row in church. I want you to picture whatever it is you're struggling with, and I want you to let the God of the universe begin to embolden you, begin to speak right to your soul. Don't you dare let go. That's what the theme is of every single one of these. Fear not. I'm with you. Be not dismayed. I am your God. I will strengthen you. I will help you. I will uphold you with my righteous right hand. Don't you dare let go. I got you. I will never leave you nor forsake you. We can say with some confidence, we can say confidently, the Lord is my helper. I will not fear. I will not let go. I'm holding on. 2 Timothy 1:7, for God has not given us a spirit of fear, but of power and love and a sound mind. That verse says there's some God-given grit hardwired on the inside of you already. You might just need to tap into it right now, but don't you dare let go. Psalm 23:4, even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. Yes, life gets really hard, but no matter how hard it gets, my God is right here with me. I can hold on. Deuteronomy 31:6, be strong and courageous in the face of disappointment, right? Do not fear or be in dread of them, for it is the Lord your God who goes with you. He will not leave you or forsake you. Those of you struggling with anxiety right now, this is your promise. Hold on to this. This is Jesus talking. Peace I leave you. Peace I leave with you. My peace I give to you. Not as the world gives, do I give to you. Let not your hearts be troubled, neither let them be afraid. Some of you need to hold on to that one right now. Now to him who is able to do immeasurably more than all we ask or imagine, according to his power that is at work within us. God says, I know some of you feel so stuck, so upset, so hopeless, so sad right now that you don't even see a better future in store. You can't even imagine it. And God says, I'm going to do things in your life that are going to blow you away, things that you can't even imagine, not by your strength, by my strength. Hold on to it. God is our refuge and strength, a very present help in trouble. Therefore, we will not fear, though the earth gives way, though the mountains be moved into the heart of the sea, though its waters roar and foam, though the mountains tremble at its swelling. You don't have to hold on to the struggle. God says, I want you to hold on to your faith. So give me the struggle so that you can hold on to the faith. Cast your burden upon the Lord and he will sustain you. He will never allow the righteous to be shaken. For the Lord your God is the one who goes with you to fight for you against your enemies, to give you the victory. Somebody say amen. I'm gonna read one more verse. And it sums up everything we just talked about and all those promises we just read. The writer of Hebrews is writing to a group of people who, like us, sometimes just wanna let go. Sometimes we just wanna walk away. Sometimes we wanna stop believing, stop trying, stop hoping. Just wanna let go. If you read the book of Acts, new Christians are now being murdered. They're being persecuted for their faith. They're being stoned to death in public. They're being executed in public. And so a bunch of people are letting go. They're going, I'm scared to death. I am letting go. I am walking away. And the writer of Hebrews says, don't let this be you, because you're gonna miss out on everything God has in store for you. Listen, he says, let us hold tightly. Don't you dare let go, son. Don't you dare let go, daughter. Let us hold tightly without wavering to the hope we affirm, for God can be trusted to keep his promise. Everything you just read, God says, I can be trusted. I will keep my word. Don't you let go. Hold on. I got you. It's usually at this point of every single service where I go, hey, everybody, let's stand up and worship. Don't do that today. Today, I want you to stay seated for a second. We're gonna do something different. Today, we're gonna sing two songs. But the first one, I want you to hear the God of the universe speaking to you. I want you to take this song in. And then we'll get up and we'll pray and we'll sing back to God and we'll worship him. But for just a minute, I want you to hear God speaking to you about your life. 3 years ago when I was in some anti-anxiety counseling, I had the worst night of my adult life. Didn't think I wanted to live anymore, the whole thing. It was really bad. And the next morning I was so exhausted. I didn't even feel like getting out of bed, and my wife put this song in the bedroom on repeat. And it began to just fill my soul with hope, fill my soul with this reminder that my God is with me. And he's working when I can't see it. He's got a plan when I don't understand it. He's doing things in my life when I can't feel it. And I don't have to let go of anything. I'm having a bad day, not a bad life. My emotions don't get to win. I'm gonna hold on. So I want you to just stay where you're at and let the God of the universe speak to you through this song.
To just be strong, and it's a fight just to keep it together, together. I know you think that you are too far gone, but hope is never lost. Hope is never lost. Those nights, but a fighter. You never know just what tomorrow holds. And you're stronger than you know. You're stronger than you know. Hold on, don't.
Stand up with me. Let's pray. God, I thank you that your presence is with us right now. No matter where we're watching or listening to this from around the world, your presence is with us right now. You are speaking right now. We thank you. We thank you for your promises. That you won't leave us and you won't forsake us and you will be our refuge. You will be our strength. You will be our hope. You will provide peace. You will provide victory. And we thank you. With everyone's eyes closed at all the locations, let me ask a couple of questions. First is, You already have a relationship with Jesus. Maybe you have for most of your life. Maybe it's brand new, but you do. And today you go, me, or I'm gonna stand in for someone that I love is struggling right now. And I'm just gonna raise my hand and say, God, we need you. If that's you, just put your hands up. We're gonna start to believe together. Me or somebody I love is struggling right now, and I'm gonna stand in the gap either for myself or for them in prayer today. God, we need you. Yeah. Second question is this. You don't have a relationship with Jesus yet. You've been kind of window shopping this whole thing. And today you can feel it in your heart. I just know it. The creator of the universe is tapping me on the shoulder. This is my moment. I want to put my faith in Jesus because I want every single one of these promises to apply to me. I want those promises that say, in him, I can do all things. I want to make sure that I am in him today. I want to make sure that he is in me today. And this is, I can tell it's my moment. I want to say, God, forgive me of my sins. I want to say yes to Jesus today. I want his spirit inside of me, but I also want heaven forever because of what he did for me. If that's you and you say, I want to say yes to Jesus today, raise your hand right now at every single location. Put them up high. I say yes to Jesus today. God, I need you. This is my moment. Amen. 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 God, I thank you. I thank you for what you're doing in this church family. I pray for every single person struggling and every single person standing in the gap for someone they care about who's struggling. And I pray, God, that we would begin to hold on to your promises like never before, that we would begin to sense your involvement in our life like never before, that we would sense your peace, your joy, your confidence, your hope in the middle of difficulties. Help us to hold on until we see the victory. And God, for those of you who for the first time are saying yes to Jesus today, God, I thank you for the eternal lives that are being changed right now. I thank you. I thank you for everyone who said, yep, I need Jesus. And I pray, God, as we begin to worship you now with music, that they would just sense your presence in such a real and authentic way. And I thank you, God, for the life-changing things that you're doing in our hearts, in our minds right now. In Jesus' name, and everybody at every location said, amen. Let's worship.